You magnificent bastards, what's up? I am DM Chuck of Defenders of Kobold. And here recently, I've kind of fallen for a exciting new game, and it is called, right there, Zweihander, Grim and Perilous RPG. And it's been a lot of fun. I really enjoy the vibe of this game. I enjoy the mechanics of the game. We're running it on the stream right now. We're in the middle of running a Bitter Harvest, the adventure that's out of the back of the Revised Core Rulebook here. And one thing that I came across as my players were making their characters is, this is a big fucking book, right? This is goddamn intimidating. So I thought it might be nice for people coming into the game, haven't played it before, maybe not too experienced, to have a quick and dirty, here's how you bang out a fucking character. So that's what we're going to do today. You and I, we're going to have ourselves a romantic little thing here. We go through the journey through the tulips of making you a fucking Zweihander character. So it's going to be fucking great. And by the time we finish up here, you should have a character that you can take to your first game session. There is shit here that you're going to need to talk to your GM about, but it's any game when you're making a character, make sure you keep your GM in the loop and ask questions. That way, what you make matches what the game's going to be about. That way there's no disconnect between expectations. Before we get into it, let's talk about what's on the screen here. That motherfucking direction. That's the character sheet we're going to use for this. Found on DriveThruRPG. I'll slap the link down below so you can download you a copy of this fantastic character sheet. Directly above me, it's just, the steps we're going to be following. Page numbers, any tidbits of information you might need to know. And then, that direction, it's just a fucking dice roller. In this, we're going to need D10s, really, that's it. At least for character creation. You're going to make D100 rolls, you're going to make D10 rolls, and in-game, you're going to make D6 rolls. So, right now, for making this character, it's totally cool if you just have your percentile with you. You can get by with that, just fucking great. Actually, 3D10, it's the most you're going to need, because that's what's you're going to need for rolling the fucking stats. So real quick, before we get into it, I just want to give you a quick rundown of what we're going to go through, and then we'll go through it. So first up in the game, we're going to roll stats. Next up, we're going to do our ancestry stuff. We're going to figure out what ancestry are, get your ancestral modifiers recorded, get your ancestral trait. We're going to calculate your bonuses. We're going to get your character archetype. Roll profession, record those profession trapping, fill in all the secondary attributes, peril, damage, encumbrance, movement, initiative. Then we're going to go into the background. There's a lot of stuff in background, but it's all real fun. So season of birth, dooming, age, distinguishing marks, complexion, clear on down through alignment. Profession. Profession's going to take a little bit. There's a decent amount of stuff you have to copy onto the character sheet. And then there'll be a little bit of research and reading when you figure out what advancements you want to buy in your first profession. Iconic trapping, that's really open-ended and a thing you'll be talking with your GM about. And then finally, we'll get the combat section filled out. So that's all the fucking shit. And then when we're done with that, you'll have your fully functioning Zweihander character ready to walk into your first fucking session. You may not know what everything does, but your GM can explain that to you. And that's kind of the fun of playing a new game, is discovering how it works as you play. Moving on to step one, roll stats. Page 29 of the Revised Core Rulebook. You can read what all the shit does there. It actually starts on page 28, step two, primary attributes. It also explains all of the bonuses, combat, brawn. We'll get to that later. So first up, we're rolling this shit, Grim and Perilous method. That's random character generation. We're rolling these stats straight down the fucking line. Going through the book, rolling on all the tables to figure this shit out. So, let's start off. First step of making a character is rolling your fucking stats. Stats are easy, 25 plus 3d10 straight down the fucking line. Once again, step one, we're going to roll them stats. Stats are going to go over there in you can see the flashing red bits. I'm going to plug in a 3 for 3d10 up on my dice roller. We're going to add 25, and we roll. So my first score is a 41, and you record it just as fucking is. I'm going to roll the rest of these. We'll recap once it's rolled and once you've got all your shit rolled. Okay, here we are. I've got all of my stats filled in over in the primary attribute boxes. With that, we're ready to move on to the next step. So, step two on this motherfucker, your ancestry. This picks up on page 31. This is a kind of human-centric game, but there are the other ancestries as well. Hopefully you talked with your GM about this. If not, you may want to talk with your GM about this. The way it kind of works is you can pick to play a human, or you can fucking roll on the table on page 31 for a demi-human ancestry. For this, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to roll to pick a demi-human, but you're more than welcome to pick human, whatever they want. Also, you need to work with your GM on this too, because who knows what the fuck they want. And all this shit that we're going to get from this step, we're going to fill into the sections that are flashing right here. So I'm going to leave it up for just a second. I'm going to roll a percentile to figure out what demi-human ancestry I'm going to get off the table on page 31. I got a 52. That is a gnome. I'm going to be playing a gnome. So up at this box on the top, let me get rid of the red there. This box on the top, plug in gnome for my gnomish ancestry. And then once you have what your main ancestry is going to be, flip to the corresponding page to that. I've got it right there. So for gnome, I'm going to be going to page 38. On these pages, there's essentially three things you need to look at least starting out. There's a blurb, you know, text box, or not box, but, you know, a couple paragraphs. This is what it means to play this ancestry in Zweihander. Next thing we need to know is the ancestral modifiers, which is we're gonna record that shit right now. If we turn back on the little red stuff, these boxes over here in the primary attributes field, that's where we're going to fill those ancestral modifiers in. So as a gnome, I get a plus one to AB, so that it goes with agility bonus. I get a plus one to IB, so intelligence bonus, and just plug in right there, plus one. I get a plus one to WB, willpower bonus. And I also get a negative one to BB, so brawn bonus. I get a negative one to CB for combat bonus. And then finally, I get a negative one to fellowship. Okay, we have our ancestral modifiers recorded. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to figure out our ancestral trait. That's also going to be on the same page. So I'm looking at gnomes, page 38. There's the ancestral traits table. Roll that shit. I get a 74. My ancestral trait is going to be thieving stunties. I don't know what the fuck that means, but I'm about to find out. Because on the page right there, opposite, so 38, then I'm looking at 39. It's got all of the ancestral traits for gnomes there. In the traits box, just record that fucking trait. If you've got the PDF, it'd be a great time for you to show off your fucking copy-paste skills. Okay, there you go. I've got my ancestral trait recorded. So once we have that, we recorded our ancestry up top, we recorded the ancestral modifiers, and then we recorded the ancestral trait. We are done with this fucking step. Let's move on. Next up is bonuses. Bonuses on the character sheet, we're going to be referencing the two red things there that are flashing and using that to populate the field that's in the green. Those are where the bonuses are going to go. Bonuses, they affect a lot of the secondary attributes. They affect combat. That's kind of what they do. The bonuses, you take the number from the 10 spot. So we're going to look at my combat bonus. So my combat's a 41. Then we're going to look at any ancestral modifiers. So as a gnome, I get an ancestral modifier for my brawn bonus of a negative one. So you take the number in a 10, so this place 4 from the 41, and you mush it together with the ancestral bonus modifier if you have one. Not all ancestries have modifiers in every field. So I got a 4 minus 1, so that's a 3. Same thing for my brawn. I got a 43, so I take that 4, subtract that 1, that's another fucking 3. Agility, it's a 46, so I take that 4, add a fucking 1 for my ancestral modifier, that makes it a 5. Perception, I don't have any ancestral modifiers in perception, so I just take the 4 from that 49, and down the fucking list. There are all of my bonuses filled out, and with that, we're done. We will reference those bonuses come the time to fill out secondary attributes, so you're gonna have to look at that shit again, but don't you fucking worry, because right now we're moving on to the next step. Oh, it's a threefer. So this one we're doing archetype professions and trapping, because they all work together. So we're going to flip to page 44. And on page 44, down there on the bottom, you're going to find the archetype table. That's a percentile roll. And we're going to record that archetype up there in that background box. So I'm going to roll my percentile for archetype. I get a 57. My archetype is going to be Ranger. The archetype will then... Each archetype has subtables on it that determine your profession. And then as you advance through the tiers of play, that archetype will come into play for your future advancements. But that's down the fucking road. Don't you worry about that now. Now just record your archetype. And then we got to figure out your fucking profession. So I got a ranger. Following that, starting on page 45 going through 50 are the tables for all of those archetypes. So as a ranger, I'm going to go to page 48. And on the archetype pages, you're going to see three things again. Text to explain what it fucking means, starting trappings, which we'll record next, and then also the profession table, the ranger profession table for me, or whatever fucking profession table for you. So I'm going to roll percentile, 47. That means I get hedgewise. My profession, after rolling it, it's going to go up there in the box that's flashing red. The next step here is our trappings. And trappings are on the second page of the character sheet. So I'm going to hop down there. And trappings get recorded here. Working off your archetype table, starting trapping section, go ahead and record all that shit right there in that box. Okay, you should have all your fucking trappings recorded. I have mine recorded. One thing I would like to note is you will have received some fucking weapons. It depends on the profession or the archetype. One thing you may want to do real quick is flip over to pages 221 through 226 in the trapping section and look at the weapons table and figure out what skills any weapons you have use. Like I got a fire hardened spear. I'm going to hop over to 221, fire hardened spear. It is... If you look at the table, find it on a table, it says, I'm on the simple melee weapons table. We'll need to know that because later on when it comes to filling out profession shit, you may get a chance to take some skill rankings in the combat area in a combat skill. And it would be good for you to take your skill ranking in a skill that you have a fucking weapon for. It kind of just depends on your profession. They should be pretty good on making sure you don't get to take skills for weapons that you don't fucking have, but you don't fucking know. Just make a mental note of that. Oh, also, you might check out if you have any armor. Like, I ended up with some hide armor. When we get to secondary attributes, that armor will affect my damage threshold or your damage threshold. And armor is on page 226 of trappings. So you might make a note that you have that armor so you can reference it later. But with that, archetype, professions, trappings, they're fucking done. We can move on to the next step, which is attributes, or it's listed as secondary attributes in the book. These are all going to reference your bonuses. The big ones are going to be your willpower bonus, your brawn bonus, your perception bonus, and your agility bonus. So be prepared to look at that shit. First up is peril. Peril is going to be your willpower bonus +3 for the first box there. So mine is a 5, I get a +3, so my peril threshold, the first number in that big box is an 8, and just in case you don't know where I'm looking at, it's them red flashing things right there. Peril kind of has different tiers that shit can overcome to move you further down the peril condition track. That shit your GM will explain, but you do need to fill out all of those boxes, and it's nice and easy. You take the first number, and you add it to 6, and it's listed there underneath, real fucking tiny like. So 8 plus 6 gets me a 14 for the first one. And then for the next one, it's going to be 8 plus 12. That's going to net me a 20. So it's just this first box plus the number underneath. And then finally, 8 plus 18. That is going to be a 26. My peril threshold is now populated right there. Next up, we're going to go down to page 2. Because now it's time to fill out damage. And it's right there under damage threshold. It works the same way. I do have later in this, I've got a thing where we're going to fill out your armor. We're going to add it to it. But if you know what your fucking armor is, I believe that was on page 226 if you got armor. You can go ahead and use that here if you want to. Or we can use it later if you forget. It's up to fucking you. But the way damage threshold is, it's your brawn bonus plus the damage threshold modifier off any armor you have. So I had hide armor, so that's a 1. And my brawn bonus up here is a 3. So that means my first number here is a 4. That's my brawn bonus plus my armor damage threshold modifier. Then it's the same thing down the fucking track. You take that first number and you add it to 6 for the second, so that's 10. You take a first number and then you add it to 12 for the, you know, next box. That's going to be a 16 for me. And then finally, you take that first number, you add it plus 18, so that's going to net me a 22. So my damage is filled out with the damage threshold modifier of my armor included in that. Now that we have those, we can move on to the other items there, which would be encumbrance, initiative, and movement along the top of the second page. Now we're going to be plugging this shit into these first boxes here that are flickering red. And it's easy. So 3 for encumbrance, it's 3 plus your brawn bonus. My brawn bonus again was a 3, so my encumbrance is 6. Movement, 3 plus your perception bonus. My perception is 4 plus that 3, so I get a 7. And then movement is 3 plus your agility bonus. My agility is a 5, and I get to add 3, so I get an 8. And there, our secondary attributes are filled the fuck out. We're done with secondary attributes. Next up is the fucking background. There's a lot of shit in background. We're going to be starting off on page 52. Flip my page. Background, all of this shit is pretty much going to get dumped into this first page. A lot of it's going to get filled into the background box along the top. There's a chance you're going to get some traits out of this. You're also going to get your age, your social class, and then we can touch on fate points real quick. But the real meaning of fate points, once again, talk to your fucking GM. So, first step in background is season of birth, found on page 52. Roll that percentile, and it will tell you what season your character was born in. So I rolled a 75. I was born in winter. Under background, I'm just going to type born in winter. This is going to reference the next step on the background, which is your dooming. Dooming's a really cool mechanic. You should read up on it, or you should ask your GM to explain what it means in your game. But for right now, roll on that percentile for your dooming. There's a dooming for each season. I got winter, so I'm going to go to the dooming of winter table on page 54. I'm going to roll that, and I get a 66. My dooming, justice, is blind, deaf, and dumb. I'm just going to dump that in the background section. Dooming, recorded. Next up is your fucking age, found on page 54. They don't give you hard numbers. They just give you a general range of age, young adult, middle age, elderly. The thing that's going to take into effect here mechanically is on the next page when we get to distinguishing marks. The further are you down that you are down that table, more distinguishing marks you get. So I'm going to roll for my age. I got an 18. That plops me down in young. So for age, I'm just going to type in young up along the top. Now this is where you need to pay attention. If you got adult, middle-aged, or elderly, you're going to get distinguishing marks from that. So if you're young, you don't get any distinguishing marks. And the distinguishing marks table starts on page 55 and continues clear through page 56. If you're young, you don't get any. If you're an adult, you get one distinguishing mark. If you're elder or middle-aged, you get 2. And if you're elderly, your old ass gets 3 distinguishing marks. So roll that shit out and record it in the background section. Once you have that recorded, we're moving on to complexion. It's a percentile. This shit's on page 57. I hit that roll button. I get a 13. My complexion is fair skin. So record that in background. Once you have your complexion figured out, then we're going to get your build type. Also on page 57, roll that fucking percentile. The build type table is up on the top. I got a 7. I am frail. So I'm going to record that here in the background box of frail. And your build type will come in on the next item, which is your height and weight. Going on pages 58, 59. Find your appropriate box. I am playing a gnome. I'm going to play that as a dude. Roll another percentile for the table associated with you. I got an 88. So my height, if I'm going off that height weight table, is 4'11". And my weight is, now this is where it comes to your build comes into play. I'm a frail build, so I use the frail line and I go to my thing. So I am 113s. We've got our frame and we've got our height and weight. Next up on this thing is going to be your hair and eye color. That shit's on page 60. I'm going to roll for my hair color, which is the top one. I get a 61. I go down to 61. For a gnome, 61, I have chestnut hair. And my eye color is, I roll again. I get a 5. with dark brown eyes. That was referencing both of the tables there on page 60. Next up is going to be your upbringing and favored attribute. Favored attribute comes into play later, so fucking worry about that later. For what you need right now, we need your upbringing. And all the different upbringings are explained on page 61. The table's also on page 61. I fucking roll a die. I get an 11. I am of cultured upbringing. Once again, record that shit in background. After you have your upbringing, we move to social class and starting money. Social class is important in this game. It affects interactions with other people. Your GM will explain that. Right now, on page 62, roll that fucking social class table. I got a 23, which plants me firmly in lowborn. In social class, it goes on the top right there next to your age. And then also while we're here, on the same table, you get your starting funds. On this character sheet, starting money is on the second page, down in the bottom center. Lowborn, I start with 3d10 plus 3 brass pennies. I start out with 18 brass pennies. Now that we have your social class, we have your money, we need to talk about drawbacks. It starts explaining drawbacks in the book on page 63. The drawbacks table itself is on page 64. Drawbacks are optional right now. You don't need to take a drawback during character creation. Drawbacks, it's going to count as a trait, so you're going to record it in the trait field. So yeah, drawbacks are optional. You start the game with one single solitary fate point. Those fate points are stupid fucking useful, so make sure you ask your GM what the fuck they do and why you want them, but trust me, you want them. By default, you start with one fate. Here, on this optional drawback table, you can choose to take a drawback, and you will get one additional fate point. You only get one additional fate point for this, so you can come out of character creation with a maximum of two fate points here. You can roll as much as you fucking want on this drawbacks table, but you're only going to net one additional fate point. So, for shits and fucking giggles, I'm gonna roll that. I got a 7, so I'm gonna up my fate points. Oops, I already did. So it was, by default, it was 1. Now it's gonna be 2. And so I want to reference 7 on the drawbacks table. That is a black cataract. So you're just gonna record it here in traits. All of the drawbacks are explained on 64, pages 64 through 66. So just record it and make sure that you just record what it does. So hang on just a second. I'm going to type in mine. There is my black cataract. We got a drawback. I gained an extra fate point, so I'm going to come out of character creation with 2 instead of 1. Once again, I could roll on this drawbacks table again, but I don't get any more fate points for it. So the last thing to do in background is going to be your alignment. That starts on page 67. Alignments on this first page are going to go up on the two boxes that are flashing red. You have an order alignment and a chaos alignment. So when we roll on the alignments table on page 67, I got a 29. You're going to record each of those. There's an order alignment line and a chaos alignment line. So I got a 29. I got diplomacy and hypocrisy. Ask your GM to explain what those two alignments are, how you play them out, and how it relates to the corruption, the order and corruption bar going in between those two. Now that we have our alignment, we are ready for the next step, which is profession. There's a lot of shit here in profession. Professions start off on page 73. We're going to start filling this out on the third page of the character sheet, and it's going to be this top section here. You start out with 1,000 reward points. You start character creation with 1,000 reward points. That gets recorded up here. This is all explained, like I said, starting on page 73 and then moving on over to 75. You start off with 1,000 reward points. It costs 100 reward points to move into your first profession. That leaves you 900 reward points to buy your first round of advances in your profession. So what you're going to do now is whatever your profession is. So mine was Hedgewise. I'm going to record it here. I am then going to go find Hedgewise in the fucking professions listing. This is going to be pages 81 through 138. So if you want to follow along with me, Hedgewise, my Hedgewise stuff, it's on page 111. There's a handful of things in Hedgewise. There's going to be text to, Hedgewise, your profession. There's a lot of stuff in your profession. There's going to be a, you know, blurb. What the fuck is your profession? What does it mean? Then you're going to have traits, and you're going to record it over here in this traits box. Some of them will just have a trait, some of them will have multiple traits, and some of them will have drawback. As a Hedgewise, I have a trait, a special trait, and a drawback. So you need to record that here in this box. Just put the fucking names. And then also on the first page, you're going to record that shit in the traits box as well. That traits box is going to get full up, so abbreviate in ways that make sense to you. The next thing you're going to see, you know, you got your text. What is it? You got your traits, drawbacks. And then there's a table called whatever your profession is advances. You're going to copy that shit over into these boxes. So if you're looking at Hedgewise on page 111, my first one's alchemy, copy of that first box, bargain, folklore. I'm just going to copy all of those into both of these fields. I'm going to do a little jump cut and I'm going to fill all these out. And then when we come back, we'll talk about what all that shit means. Okay, here we are. I've got all of this shit filled out, my profession. I've got all three of the traits, the two traits and the drawbacks stuffed into here. So the font on that poor box, it's so tiny now. And then I've also got all of these filled out. While I was there, I went back up to the first page and I filled out all of the extra stuff here in the traits box. So I got my hedge wizardry, my arcane magic, cruel tutelage. If you got a spellcaster, we'll come back to this after combat. I'll just throw it in there to kind of show you what I'm going to do. But it explains it very well. Like my special trait, arcane magic, I get to pick up three generalist spells and I'll just record them on the, what is it, the fourth page here for magic. And it's up to you and your GM to figure out how the fuck that works. So yeah, I filled out my traits and then I filled out all of this shit. So as I was saying earlier, start off with 1,000 reward points. Cost you 100 to enter your first profession. So for me, it cost 100 to enter Hedgewise. That leaves me 900 reward points. Each one of these things costs 100 reward points. So you get to pick out 9. You have skill ranks, you have bonus advances, and then you have some talents down here. Skill ranks, they're all explained on page 191. Bonus advances, those are going to affect these here. So it may increase your peril threshold, your damage threshold, movement encumbrance. It may increase weapon damage. It may increase spell casting shit, but that's what those are used for. And then talents are talents, you know. You pick a talent, you get some special effect. So you get to pick out 9 of those. So pick out your 9. I'll pick out my 9. When we come back, we'll go through updating changes from those advances on the character sheet. So you do you, I'll do me. We'll reconvene after this jump cut. Okay, here we are. I've got my 9 picked out. I zoomed in on this a little bit so you can better see what I got. So for my 9, I picked alchemy, handle animal, incantation, simple melee, survival, and then I took an increase to my willpower bonus. Then I took the 3 talents. One thing you need to know, if you are a spellcaster, incantation is the spellcasting skill. So if you got a spellcaster class, I would recommend you take it. You know, you do you, but mechanically it would make a lot of sense if you fucking took an incantation. Next thing that's going to happen is we need to update the character sheet on these. So remember what you got, go to the first page. The fields we're going to be updating. If you increased a skill ranking, you're going to put a check in this first row of boxes. At the basic tier of the game, you only get to put a check in the first row. So I have alchemy. I also have handle animal. I have incantation. Then I have simple melee, which is up top. And then I have survival. And then also I got one ranking increase to my willpower bonus, and that's going to be recorded under this little advanced section here. So I'm going to put a check there. And then I also got the 3 talents, and I'll record these later. I'll fill those out later. You need to fill them out right now, right? But I don't need to fill that out to show you how to type in words in a box. The skill rankings, you put your check mark in. There's nothing else you need to do with that right now. That shit comes into play during gameplay. What you do need to focus on is if you did any advances here. So I did one advance under willpower. That is going to increase my willpower bonus from a 5 to a 6. Each one of those little checks gets you an advance. And then you need to make sure that you update any other fields that change with that. So my peril does change with that because peril is 3 plus WB. So I need to increase each one of those. So we've purchased, we got our starting RP, we filled out our professions table, we spent our 900. You have to spend all 900 here. You can't go into the game with any leftover RP. So spend it all here, buy all 9, record your shit. With that, we're done with professions. Quick note though, once we're done with the combat section, I'm going to go ahead and pick my spells out and I'll just show you. I mean, you go to the spell section, mine's generalist magic, and you just fucking record this shit. After profession, iconic trappings. Iconic trappings. trappings. It's explained on page 76 in the book. You're going to record it in the trappings box here. It is something that goes along with your profession. You can look at the trapping section on page 215. Like a character I had a cultist, and so he had the blood magic talent, so I could sacrifice creatures to do better at my spellcasting. So my iconic trapping there was a bag full of kittens, so I could pull a kitten out and sacrifice it and then do good job at casting. Maybe if you had a gambler, you might take some loaded dice or, you know, a deck of cards with a bunch of extra aces. If you're a barber surgeon, you might take a bone saw. As a hedgewise, my iconic trapping for this, and this is another time that it's important to check with your GM. Make sure what you pick out fits. Is an OP. My iconic trapping is going to be a spell component bag, and I'm probably going to have it contain all of the components for my spell. So we'll do each spell for, and we're going to have it also have the components. And when I pick out my spells, I could go through here and I could list out each required component for spellcasting there. So we'll go with that. My iconic trapping is spell component bag with enough components to cast each of my spells like 3 times. Nice and easy, gets me started into the game with what I need to do. But as I'm playing in the game, I'm going to have to pay attention and make sure that I am gathering new spell components as we play. So now that we've got iconic trappings, we're going to look at combat. There's a lot of shit with combat. We're on the second page here. The top box here is where we're going to record our weapons and all the stats for our weapons. Depending on what the weapon is, that will kind of depend on what kind of like damage or what skill is used. But the first thing I want to do before we move on here is I want us to fill out the dodge and parry, because that's gonna make a difference later on. If we head up to first page of the character sheet, here we go. Combat and agility are what's used to populate dodge and parry. Combat, simple. I have a fire-hardened spear. I use simple melee for that. My parry, so parry is if someone's attacking you, you can use your weapon to interject and protect yourself, as long as you have a weapon that can parry. Not all of them. Dodge is someone projectile weapons at you. You can try and dodge out of the way as long as it's not a firearm. And that's a coordination test. So let's fill out my parry. I have 1 rank in simple melee. Having a rank in something increases the chance by 10%. So my base combat is 41. I have a rank in it. That means my parry is going to be a 51. So 41 plus the 10% off having a rank in it. My dodge, however, that's a coordination check once again. I don't have shit in coordination, so it's just going to be my base agility score. So my chance to dodge is a 46. You'll need to know this come combat. Your GM will explain it. Now that I have my dodge and parry, we're going to go ahead and fill out the weapons box. Now, I told you earlier, make a mental note of any weapons you come across. I have a bullwhip, which I think is a weapon. I'm gonna put it up there because it's not gonna be my primary. And then I also have a fire hardened spear. So moving into filling out these weapons page, the weapons tables are on pages 221 to 224, but you're also going to need a reference when filling this out. You're going to need to reference the weapons qualities on page 217 through 218. Let's hop over to page 221 in the book. I'm going to use my two weapons as the example here so you can see how it's done. I have a bullwhip and I have a fire hardened spear. They are both simple melee weapons. So the skill that I'm going to use for this is going to be simple melee. Now, at the top of each of these tables, it says what it is. So if you've got, you know, like a court sword or a military lance, that's a martial melee, you'll use the martial melee skill. If you have simple ranged weapons, you use simple ranged, martial range. It fucking carries over. First thing, we got simple melee and we got simple melee. Next up is load. These are melee weapons. They don't have a load. Ranged weapons, firearms, those will have a load speed. You'll fill that out there. Handling. There's a line for handling on this. Both of my bullwhip is one-handed, and then my spear is one or two-handed. Next field is distance. These are both melee. Actually, they're both engaged or 1 yard. So they got a little bit of reach to them. It'd be like the D&D equivalent of a reach weapon, right? Damage. We're gonna bypass this damage field because the shit we put in quality is very likely to affect what we put in damage. By default, your weapon damage is going to be use your combat bonus, your CB. But some weapons have shit that affect that. So if you have like a finesse weapon, and that's all weapon quality. So before I get into that, let's look at my weapon qualities. My bullwhip is entangling, ineffective, and reach. My fire-hardened spear is adaptable, reach, and weak. So hang on just a second. I'm going to do a little cut. I have filled out the qualities. It is a very tiny box. I'm going to zoom in. So we have our qualities. While we're here, let's go ahead and fill out encumbrance for these. My fire-hardened spear is a 2 for encumbrance, and my bullwhip is a 1. What we need to look at now is for like filling out the damage, we need to double check and see if any of those qualities will affect it. So if we go to pages 217 to 218. So my first thing is my spear. It has adaptable. Whenever weapons of this quality are held in two hands instead of one for the attack action, add a +1 to damage. Okay. Doesn't change. So like I was saying, like if you have a finesse weapon, you'll use AB instead of CB for your damage. If you have a pummeling weapon, you'll use your BB, your brawn bonus, instead of CB, your combat bonus. So you just need to check your qualities and see if it fucks with that. Both of mine, let's see, what else do I got? My bullwhip has entangling, and my bullwhip also has ineffective. What the fuck is that? Does not deal damage or inflict injuries. So my bullwhip, I'm just going to put, we're just going to put some lines because it doesn't deal damage. So a good thing I looked that up. The damage for the spear is going to use my CB, and all weapons, when you do the attack, if it's a weapon that deals damage, it also deals an additional 1d6. So it's going to be like your CB bonus plus 1d6. Or, you know, if it's a pummeling, your BB bonus plus 1d6. And when you get into combat, your GM will explain the kind of the cool stuff with that 1d6. So there's that shit. You got your weapon name, you got what skill it uses, loading if it has a load, handling, ranged. Both of these have reach, so they're either engaged or 1 yard away. Damage, my bullwhip doesn't do damage because it's ineffective. But my spear, if I use it one-handed, it's my CB plus 1d6. If I use it two-handed, it's CB plus 1 plus 1d6. I've got my qualities recorded, and I've got my encumbrance recorded. Next thing, we touched on armor earlier, but the next item in the list is your damage threshold if you didn't record your armor then. Armor is on page 226 of the Revised Core Rulebook. Each armor has a damage threshold modifier. There's some other qualities to it too, so like if you had clothing, it's dangerous and natural, so look up what the fuck that means. A lot of that shit is heavy. Spell casting, you cannot cast spells when wearing heavy armor. Incantation just doesn't fucking work, so keep that in mind. Combat's filled out. Anyway, so I was saying, if you hadn't already recorded it, damage threshold modifier BB plus that damage threshold modifier from your armor if you're wearing armor. Next, I was going to do spell casting. I am a hedgewise. I have arcane magic. I get 3 generalist spells. Let's go ahead and do that. Generalist spells are on page 294. That's where it starts off with, so let's hop over there. It's got the list of all the general spells as an arcane spellcaster, and my ability. It lets me take 3. Read through those if you have spell casting and record that shit. That shit's going to get recorded on the 3rd page in here. Here we go. I've filled out my spells. One thing you want to pay attention to in this is regents. My regent for Aegis is a splinter of a wooden shield kept in my pocket. It is not expended on casting. Regents for Kakanda Grasp is a dab of animal fat. And then Shuddai is a handful of sand poured onto the ground, expended. Now notice it says expended for Shuddai and also for Kakanda Grasp. But there it is. I am ready for my first session of play. Yeah, that's it. Congratulations, you've made a character. I guess moving out of this, I do want to give a shout out to the Zweihander crew. They are an amazingly cool group of people. Dan Fox, the creator of Zweihander, he has been super open and willing to help and ask questions. He's actually invited us up to his place, the town he lives in, and he ran a game for Jake and I. He was super cool. He gave us an early copy of Main Gaush. This is an amazing book. If you're watching this in the future and it's out, you should definitely buy it. If you're watching this in, you know, the future where it hasn't come out yet, you should pre-order that shit on Amazon. Professions, spells, all sorts of cool new shit for players. And there's also a bunch of shit for GMs, you know, how to make monsters, how to make NPCs. It's also got a full fucking thing on vehicle combat. So It's super fucking cool. I just want to give a shout out to Adam, the rules guy of Zweihander, my BFF, because I said so, and he didn't say no. So Adam, he's our first patron over here on Defenders of Cobalt, which is super fucking cool of him. He's also working on a new setting for Zweihander. It's called Radiator. So it's a whole new setting, still based on the Grim and Perilous Zweihander rule set, but it's post-apocalyptic nuclear fallout. It's really fucking cool. He invited me up to his place and I got to do a little bit of the alpha play testing with him. I got to set in for a session of that podcast here in the next couple of weeks. I'm going to be up there again to play in another session of the alpha play testing. All that shit's getting released on their Patreon. So if you want to hear the podcast of this new setting as it's formed, you know, as Adam's creating it, you need to sign up as one of their patrons. And also, bonus, you'll get to hear my voice a couple times in some of those episodes. So it's really cool. Once again, the Zweihander people, they're fucking amazing. And they've made an amazing game. So you should definitely check it out. Next up, I want to plug our sponsor over there, down there. As always, we're sponsored by Libris Arcana. Great dice service. They do a dice subscription. If you're going to sign up for their dice subscription service, they offer a monthly or a quarterly. Use discount code COBALD at checkout and you'll get 20% off your first subscription purchase. So it's super fucking cool. Once again, shout out to Adam, our patron. If you want to help me and the other defenders keep making awesome content, head on over to our Patreon page and fucking, you know, throw us some money. We're poor and desperate and in need of positive reinforcement. And your dollar bills hit all of those fucking marks. That's all I got. Good job on making a character. Until I see you next time, start fires, do drugs, and tip your bartenders.